Hi, thanks for joining us for another bite-sized talk that's focused on pipelines. I'd like to begin by thanking the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative for funding NF Core events and our outreach and initiatives. And I'd also like to extend a special thanks to the volunteers that helped us organize the recent hackathon 2 weeks ago. Now, we've recently received funding from the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative that is focused on boosting diversity and inclusion. And Evan mentioned a few full-time paid positions for developer advocates for this purpose in the announcements channel on Slack. Please reach out to us for more information and keep an eye out for the official advertisement of the positions and spread the word when they're out. Now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our speaker today. We're joined by Lorena Pantano from Next RNA Therapeutics in the US, who will be presenting the NF Core smRNA-seq, so small RNA-seq pipeline. If you have any questions for our speaker today, please unmute yourself at the end of the talk or use the chat function and I will read out your questions. So Lorena, we appreciate how early in the morning it is for you. So thank you very, very much for making the time to present for us at bytesize. Over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, no, thank you for having me in mind to share my contribution to the community. I'm very happy to be here. And it's a sunny day, so it's pretty awesome, the view. So I'm going to talk about this pipeline, the small RNA-seq pipeline. And what I'm going to do is to give a background, a scientific background, before starting into talking more the analysis. And I always think about the small RNA as a small non-coding RNA. And there are different kinds of a small non-coding RNA that some of them are handled by the pipeline, others currently not, or maybe there are better pipelines for that. So when we talk about the small, it's good to give a size range. So it could go even to a little bit shorter than 20, maybe 18 to 400. And they are involved in different biological functions. So we have gene regulation where we have microRNAs that are very well known. And together with microRNAs, we have endogenous siRNA and pRNAs that are a little bit longer. We have others that are more in the range of 100, 200 that are involved in post-transcriptional modification, like poly-A or RNA nucleotide modification. And others from similar size in the translational machinery, like tRNA, transferrin RNA or ribosomic RNA. And then there are others that we are unclear of the function, but as well are annotated and are part of this group of small molecule. So I'm going to go a little bit over the ones that the pipeline can handle. And although not all of them right now have tools that will quantify them properly, but it's something that we want to work towards that. So in general, when we talk about these very small RNA molecules, we are talking about sizes between 18 to 33. And normally the biogenesis can come from double-strand RNA or hairpin kind of structures, and it will process probably by dicer, but not always, analog machinery to perform some kind of gene silencing. But this not... it's not always like that, but it's a good summary of what it could be. So the microRNA, these are the most well-studied small RNA. The precursor of that normally is a big primary precursor that contains several hairpin structures. And this is this long precursor is cleavage just around this hairpin structure to form the pre microRNA. This still is in the nucleus, and then it will go to the cytoplasm to get the final mature microRNA thanks to dicer. And at the same time that this process, it will find what RNA it will target by nucleotide complementarity. And there is a lot of research done in that this kind of silencing can go to mRNA degradation or translational repression. The one thing that maybe not a lot of people know is about the variability or variations that you find in microRNAs. So it's very well known that microRNA is not just one single RNA molecule. Like everything we know, there are variations, and it's not only single nucleotide variations. They are as well variation at the beginning and at the end of the sequence. So these are called isomers, and they were first described, I think, 2008. And there is a lot of research on that. So this modification is important. It will change the function. They will correlate to different stages in the cells, to diseases. So it's important to understand that maybe when you want to analyze these, you want to differentiate at least the type of variations that you have. For endogenous siRNAs, they have been described a lot in C. elegans and Drosophila. They are involved in regulation. They have a similar kind of biogenesis. They can come from hyper or double strand RNA, even in cis or trans. But at the end, they will go to the cytoplasm and it will perform a similar regulation. And here is where it comes, all the field of using siRNA, exogenous siRNA to knock down genes. And finally, but not least, although there are a few other categories, pRNAs are as well, they appear later. They are a little bit longer, from 26 to 30 nucleotide long. They have some modifications at the end of the sequence. And they were discovered the first time by regulating the transposons in the genome. So when everything gets methylated, demethylated, many of the transposons are active, and this is a way to regulate that. And it will create, in this feedback loop, a small RNA that will have this size, and it will amplify, so it will then bind to the DNA to get methylation or directly to degrade the RNA from the transposons. So that as well, it got a lot of interest in the past years. And other type of small RNA are coming from tRNAs actually. This is, there is a lot of investigation in here. They have been used a lot as biomarkers in cancer, different diseases. The function is still unclear, although there are a lot of more information. But the idea of the biogenesis, when you do a small RNA, seq and analyze the data, if you quantify this kind of RNAs, you will find that there are fragments, small RNAs that are belonging to one side or another, or the top of the bottom. And they are pretty, like you see, there is like high abundancy, so there is no way that that this is a degradation, because it's just a conserved part of the whole molecule, and they have been correlated to many diseases already. And then this, in the same way that there are fragments coming from tRNA, there are fragments coming from other nuclear RNAs. And in the same way, this is still less unclear, but there is some kind of conservation of the fragmentation or the processing of these RNAs. So this is why people keep quantifying and see what could be the function. So as you see, maybe many of you already know, but there is not only about microRNA, there is a lot of type of RNA. And ideally, in a comprehensive pipeline, you want to try to quantify and to characterize all of them. It's very hard to put all that together. So I will go through the pipeline, the analysis, that how it will look like, and what is integrated in the NF-core pipeline, and what is more to come. So there is a lot of people working on that at different times, and I hope that more people will come, because as you see, it's not that a simple case to analyze this data. So one thing that is recurrent is like people, because small is not super quantitative word, that you will think that, oh, you have 200 nucleotides kind of sequencing data, and you think it's small, and you will try to use this pipeline. I wouldn't recommend that. I think that anything, like if your pipeline is enriched mainly in fragments more than 50, the best pipeline to use is RNA-seq. Maybe there should be another pipeline for this, but all the tools that this small RNA-seq pipeline is integrated is based that you're going to find a lot of duplication of the reads because your molecules are like shorter than the read length normally you have. So I will say that this is a good kind of yes or no decision making. If you have a mixed one, I have done a lot that I have analyzed the data with this pipeline and then the untrimmed reads, I will put it in the RNA-seq because sometimes you have a very heterogeneous kind of library. So you can do that, that is fine. The main challenges of the pipeline is the isomer detection because there are a lot of changes in a very small region. And right now we have some strategy, but ideally we'll integrate more. There are small RNA that come from places that are in multiple parts of the genome, so it's difficult to handle that. And depending on the library, you may have difficulty differentiate what is degradation or functional molecules. And as well, when you go to non-model organisms, things get a little bit difficult. So ideally, a perfect pipeline should try to address all this. The first step will be trimming, and the trimming is related to the library prep. So there are different library preps. Normally there is variation of the two main, that is the TrueSeq, where you have just adapter to your molecule, RNA molecule or cDNA molecule in this case, or you have a kind of NextFlex where you have some degenerated bases at the end at the beginning of the cDNA, so you need to take that in account. The pipeline is compatible with a few protocols, but not probably not all the combinations, and that is another issue we keep having all the time, try to adapt to all the possible combinations. So the pipeline is divided in processing and QC, detection annotation of non-microRNAs, and try to discover the novel. So in processing and QC, we use Trim Galore. We have FastQC integrating there. Mirtrace I will give an example of this, but it's a good QC tool. And of course, multi-QC to put everything together. I would like to integrate Qualimat to give you an idea of any other small RNA that you have, although Mirtrace help with that already. For detection annotation, we have both and some tools as an easy way to know how much you have for mapping to mature, precursor, or genome. And then MirDip2 as well give you a quantification of microRNA, and MirTop will be focused on isomers. I really want to integrate MintMapper or any other tool that handles tRNA. There are some options because, as I say, they have become very important. And for the novel, we have MirDip2 will do the job for that, but there are other tools, IsoCluster or Protag for pRNAs that they will try to handle other kind of RNAs. So an example of MirTrace, it has a lot of different QC metrics, but this one I like because it gives you an idea of the diversity of your sample, and it will quantify what belongs to microRNA, to ribosomal RNA, to tRNA, to maybe PCR artifacts or primer dimers. And so it gives you quickly an idea of what samples are better, or if you have anything that you need to remove. For the quantification, as I say, after trimming and MirTrace, you will go to MirTube, MirDip2, and both ion sum tools. And what you are going to have is a matrix of a microRNA and isomers from these tools. And this is what you will use for differential expression. MirTop is compatible with the isomer R package in Bioconducture, and it gives you a lot of tools to really understand isomers, like a map of the different isomers abundance in different samples. Sometimes you see difference, but it is helping you then maybe to decide where to focus. And finally, this is the part that needs more work. Right now, mirdip2 is running different samples. A better strategy will be to collapse all the samples into one to run mirdip2, so you can really detect everything at once and then maybe separate the quantification. But right now it's running in the different samples. And here is where SecCluster and other tools that are focused in characterizing other kind of non-coding RNAs will be good to be added at some point. And from this, you will have the matrix, and you can work with visualization and differential expression as you wish. So an example of mirdip2 it will give you the secondary structure of the RNA, where the mature are there. So these visualizations are pretty cool. And it's good to go over that to see if you have any kind of new microRNA in your samples. So just as a summary, the current pipeline is, it has a very comprehensive QC with mirtrace. The microRNA isomers are very well quantified, but I will say that it needs a couple of more tools to be a better pipeline. The novel microRNA detection and quantification with mirdip2 is there, so that is good. We are migrating to the second version of NextFlow. What this is been a massive work for many people, and we are almost there. We are working with some final details, so hopefully we can get it done in a few weeks. Mainly is the versioning and maybe adding some more QC metrics. And my idea is, because I have this kind of data in my current job, so it gives me an excuse to work on this, but I would really like to add other tools to make it a better pipeline. And if anybody wants to help, is very well welcome, or any other pipeline, I'm happy to help in any way there as well. So as I say, this is a work of many. I couldn't put everybody here, but I really appreciate everybody. I really appreciate NextFlow and F-Core community. I think that is helping a lot of people, beginners, experts, everybody. So I really like the vision and the core values. And so I want to thank contributors, as well people enabled in this.